Hi, welcome to another Algebra 1 video. In this video, we're looking at section 3.6, part 4 of linear function transformations. In this video, we will learn about the vertical stretching and shrinking of linear functions, and we will also learn about combined linear function transformations. Before we talk about vertical stretching and shrinking of linear functions, let's first do a recap on what linear function transformations are. In part 1 of the series of 3.6, we learned that the parent function is the simplest form of all linear functions. In function notation, we know that this parent function for all linear functions is f of x equals to x. You can also rewrite this function as y equals to x. Over the last few parts, we've also learned about what the linear function transformations are, namely the translation transformation, the reflection transformation, and horizontal stretching and shrinking of linear functions. For translations, we learned that the general equation for every translation of the parent function y equals to x will be f of x equals to x minus h plus k. And in this case, the h factor is what determines how much your function is moving to the right or to the left, depending by the sign. And the k value tells you by how much your function is being pushed upwards or downwards. For the reflection transformation of linear functions, we learned that there are two types of reflection transformations. One of them is the negative f of x, and the second one is f of negative x. In the first one, the negative f of x, you're only changing your y values as you multiply them by the negative 1 factor, while in f of negative x, you're multiplying all of your x values by negative 1, and not the y values by negative 1. We also learned about some key differences in both of these functions by how the placement of the negative factor affects the reflection and the line of reflection. In negative f of x, we learned that you're reflecting your function across the x-axis, while in f of negative x, you're reflecting across the y-axis. Now, the third type of transformation is horizontal stretching and horizontal shrinking. In horizontal stretching, you have f of a times x, where a is some factor which is greater than 0, but it's less than 1. And that a factor deals with how much your function is being stretched. These constraints of a being greater than 0 and being less than 1 tell us that a is a fraction. So when a is a fraction in f of a times x, then your function will be stretched horizontally with respect to the parent function y equals to x. However, in horizontal shrinking, your function general equation will still be f of a times x, where a is some factor which is greater than 1. In this case, you're not stretching the function, but in fact, you're shrinking the function. Or in other words, you're compressing the function so that the gradient or the slope gets steeper. Now, one thing to know for both of these transformations, the horizontal stretching and horizontal shrinking, is that your stretch factor is given by the reciprocal of your a value. Now that we're done with the recap, let's go back to talking about vertical stretches and vertical shrinks. So let's begin with vertical stretches. In vertical stretches and both vertical shrinks, your a factor is being multiplied with f of x. So the difference here is that instead of multiplying the x value with the a, you're multiplying the whole function with the a value, which means that you're changing your y parts and not the x parts. For vertical stretches, your a times the f of x value will only be true if a is greater than 1. So if your a value is greater than 1, for example 1.5, then that will be considered a vertical stretch. Now, for vertical shrinks, it's a bit different. Your general function will still be a times f of x, so you're not changing your x part or the independent variable part, but you're multiplying the a to the whole function, which means that you're changing the y part of the function. Now, your y is still constricted to a being greater than 0, and it has to be less than 1. So this tells us that a is a fraction in vertical shrinks. In vertical shrink, since your a value is a fraction, when you multiply with f of x, it's going to shrink your function vertically so that it gets more horizontal or towards being a flat line as compared to the parent function y equals to x. Now, before I explain how both of these transformations, the vertical stretch and the vertical shrink, look when you graph them on a coordinate plane, you have to note that your a factor will also equal to your stretch factor. So for the vertical stretch, if your a factor is 1.5, then your stretch factor for a vertical stretch will also be 1.5. It's not going to be a reciprocal like horizontal stretches and horizontal shrinks. So here on this coordinate plane on the left, I've graphed the function f of x equals to x plus 1. On this function, I will perform a vertical stretch by a factor of 2, so our a value will be equal to 2. Before we perform the transformation, let's first look at the details of this original function that I've graphed in the black line. In this function f of x equals to x plus 1, we can see that the y-intercept is at the point 0, 1, and we can see that there is a constant increase in the x for every increase in the y values for this function, and this increase in y over the change in x will equal to 1 for this function. Let's see how it changes when we graph the transformed function when a equals to 2. Before we do the transformation, let's mark some points on this original function. Now let's perform the vertical stretch on this function when a, or the factor, equals to 2. For vertical stretches, you know that you're not multiplying the x values by the stretch factor, which will be 2 in this case. Instead, you're multiplying the y values for all of these points by the stretch factor of 2. So you're not going to multiply the 1 in this point or the 0 in this point. You're going to multiply the 2 in this point and the 1, which are both the dependent variables of this function, by the stretch factor. So for the first point, 1, 2, if you multiply the y part of this function because it's a vertical stretch by a factor of 2, then you get that your point is 1, 4 because 2 times 2 is 4. So your point for this function will be over here. Similarly, for the second point, 0, 1, your stretch factor is 2, so you multiply the 1 over here, the dependent variable, by 2, and your stretch factor will give the new point, which is 0, 2. Now for this point on the x-axis, your point will not change, because when you multiply 2 by 0, you get 0, so your point will still be at the x-axis. What this calculation of the point tells us is that your x-intercept will remain the same for both vertical stretches and vertical shrinks. However, your y-intercept has changed from 0, 1 to 0, 2. And the same will be the case for vertical shrinks. Now let's look at the next point, negative 2, negative 1. For this case, we know that the negative 1 is the y part of this point, so we can multiply it by 2, which gives us negative 2, negative 2 as our new point, which lies over here. And for negative 3, negative 2, we can multiply this negative 2 by 2, which gives negative 3, negative 4, and that point will lie over here. Now all you have to do is connect the dots and you'll see how the function has been transformed from the original function f of x equals to x plus 1. And the red graph is the transformed function of the original function. Now let's analyze some details of how the transformed function is different from the original function and what the similarities of them are. The first similarity is that in the red function, you have the same x-intercept as the black function or your original function f of x equals to x plus 1. We also know that your x-intercept is still the same, which is negative 1, 0, because when you multiply 0 by the stretch factor, you will always get 0 for your y value. The differences, however, are that your y-intercept has been changed. Your y-intercept has been changed from 0, 1 to 0, 2 when you multiplied the 1 by the stretch factor of 2. And we can also see that the slope of this function has been changed. It has been doubled from the original function, which had a slope of 1. And now your gradient, or the slope, or the change in y over the change in x, is the ratio of 2 over 1. So now your slope has been doubled. Now let's see how vertical stretch differs from vertical shrink by graphing a vertical shrink transformation when a equals to 1/2. In this case, our original function will be the same as the previous one on the vertical stretched one, f of x equals to x plus 1, which is in this black line. Before we do the transformation, let's mark the points. So there are my points, and now let's do the transformation of the vertical shrink by a factor of 1/2. Performing a vertical shrink on this function is similar to doing a vertical stretch. You're multiplying the y values on this function by the vertical shrink factor of 1/2. So in this case, you're going to multiply all of your y values for all of these points that I have on this black line by 1/2, but you're not going to multiply by the x values on these points. So if you make a picture of this when you do this transformation, you can imagine that the function is going to get less steep, and it's still going to have the same x-intercept. So for the first point, 1, 2, we know that we're going to multiply this y part of this point by 1/2. We know that 1/2 of 2 gives us 1, so our new point will be 1, 1, which lies over here. For the second point, 0, 1, we will have this y value over here, 1, which gives us 0.5, or 1/2, so our new point will be 0, 1/2. Now we can see already that our y-intercept has been changed, and it's a good sign because it's one of the properties of all vertical stretches and vertical shrinks. And now when we perform the vertical shrink on the third point on the x-axis, that point will remain over here because 0 times 1/2 will still give us 0. So our new point will still be the same as negative 1, 0. Now let's look at negative 2, negative 1. For this point, we're going to multiply the y value by 1/2. So our new point will be negative 2, negative 1/2. And our new point will lie over here. Let's do the same for the final point, negative 3, negative 2. When we multiply this negative 2 value by 1/2, we get negative 3, negative 1, and our new point will lie over here. Now let's connect all the dots and see what this red line looks like. So there's my red line with all the points, which is also the transformed function that has undergone a vertical shrink by a factor of 1/2. Now let's analyze some of the features of this transformed function. We can see that the similarities between both of the functions f of x equals to x plus 1 and the red transformed function is that our x-intercept has remained the same, which is negative 1, 0. However, as expected, our y-intercept has been changed from 0,1 to 0,0.5. And we can also see that the slope has been decreased from the slope of 1 to slope of 1/2 because of the stretch factor. Now let's look at some combined transformation problems in terms of equations to see how all of the transformations that we have learned in these four parts work together to explain transformed functions. In this first question, we're given the function f of x equals to x plus 1. And we're asked to find the equation for the function when it undergoes a transformation of 0.5 times f of x. So we can see that 0.5 is between 0 and 1. And so this is a vertical shrink of the original function by a factor of 0.5. So what we do is multiply the whole function by 0.5 because we can see that in this changed function, we're multiplying f of x by 0.5. Therefore, we multiply x plus 1 by 0.5. And if we do that, we get 0.5 times x plus 1. And so we can simplify this, which will give us that the transformed function of f of x will be 0.5 times x plus 0.5 times 1, which gives us 0.5. So from this, we can see that our slope has changed from 1 to 0.5, and our y-intercept has also changed from 1 to 0.5, which explains the properties of vertical stretches and vertical shrinks. In the second question, we're given the original function f of x equals to negative x plus 2. And we're asked to find the transformed function where we have 2 times f of x minus 2 plus 5 outside. So there's many transformations that are going on in this transformation. So our transformed function in unsimplified terms will be 2 times negative times x minus 2 close bracket plus 5. And if we further simplify this expression, we get that our new function will be equal to negative 2x plus 9. So we can see by combining all of the transformations on the original function negative x plus 2, we get a completely different function negative 2x plus 9. And what's interesting in the end is that both of these functions are related to the parent function y equals to x through all of these transformations that are in both of the functions. And this is it for transformations. We're done with section 3.6. Leave a like if you found this video helpful and subscribe for more videos in the future. And I'll see you in the next video. Thanks for watching.